I'm Daniel Orsagon. I'm an informatic guy with some interests related to decentralized networks, networks in general, combinatorics and functional concepts. And in my professional time, I work as a network admin at the computing department of the University of Kiel. And I'm an active member of the Kiel Freifunk community. So what's this talk about? DHCP is an IPv4 auto-configuration mechanism which was concepted when every network was centralized, organized, and we tried to decentralize that, and that's not straightforward. But we came out with a solution, and the DHCP daemon solves all the problems we identified and improves the IPv4 configuration a lot in mesh networks we like to use. So, to give you a little bit guide to the talk, we will first talk a little bit about DHCP, from when it comes from and where it will evolve to, maybe. And then I will give you a little introduction how DHCP works, and we will then evolve a centralized network into what we think networks should look like and see which problems come up. And then we will talk about the distributed DHCP algorithm a little bit, and we will have some measurements about our first rollout. Okay. Let's start with DHCP. DHCP is a rather old protocol, 25 years old, was hacked on top of BootP, which is itself 33 years old, evolved a lot in the past, and if you have enough time, you can have a look into that bunch of RFCs and see how it evolves and how it works. So, but let's have a look at the basics. What is a DHCP daemon? DHCP daemon is basically a resource manager for IP addresses, and it has some negotiation protocol with which she can negotiate addresses to the clients and then gives them additional information also. So, and we are now have a look how these negotiation of leases is working. Initially, the client joins the network, and initially he has no address and no knowledge about the network, so he just asks for information by sending a DHCP discover and doing this because he has no address. Now he broadcasts this discovery. And then every DHCP server in that network sees that package and say, yeah, okay, I have an address for you and I will send an offer. And then the client sees all the offers, selects one, and then sends back a request for that offer, which the server hopefully acknowledges. And in the last step, we can see the client can configure itself with the information provided. So all these links are broadcasts. Also all these communication steps are broadcasted through the whole network, and an address that is leased has a leased time, so finally at some time the lease is near end and the client needs to renew its lease, and he can then send a unicast packet, which now he has an address, so he can unicast to the server and ask for a renew. And hopefully the server will say, yeah, okay, you can have that address again for some hour or so. Okay, then let's see how networks look like where DHCP is concepted for. So classical network structures can really separate into three parts. There's the central stuff where the gateways and the DNS servers and so on sits, and also the DHCP server. And there's some switching layer, mostly the big cable boxes, and behind that there are those clients. And when we migrate that a little bit further to mesh networks, what we basically do is replacing the switching layer with mesh nodes. So now the mesh nodes not only connect to the central components, but also connect to each other. So in this step, we don't have all the functions we need for having a running IPv4 network on the mesh nodes. So we still need the central components, which it's, yeah. Our networks, mesh networks, are dynamically adapting to current situations. So when you have a new mesh node, you must adapt your routings inside the. And so we are really, really determined to minimize amount of traffic in those networks. And you can count DHCP as management traffic. And sadly, this traffic scales with the number of clients. So if you have like 1,000 clients, you have 1,000 clients speaking DHCP to the central network, so the central stuff, and that's nothing we like. So next step, it's natural idea to move those DHCP from the central stuff that we want to get rid of into the nodes. So now we have that in the nodes, we can get rid of the central stuff. And yeah, okay, I earlier talked about there can be multiple DHCP servers, and every server can announce an offer to the clients, so we don't want that. So to avoid confusion, we only say, okay, one DHCP daemon on a node only serves its own clients. So finally, we have restructured that network step by step down. But now each DHCP server needs a bunch of configuration parameters for runtime. And what about them? How do we transport them? So in the beginning, our DHCP server serves from a large pool of addresses. And when we move the DHCP server into the nodes, how do we distribute which addresses will we do to distribute there? And the answer is, this answer is really, really simple. You just divide that network into smaller networks, and and each node can then distribute a smaller part of that network to its client. But then we must ask ourselves, how do we distribute those networks? And there are networks which don't have any services for that, which then have a guy sitting somewhere and distributes them by maintaining a list. And this guy is the central component again. So yeah, okay, maybe that's not a good idea. And then there's a question, how large should those subnetworks be? Should they be the same size on every node? But some nodes need more addresses because they have more clients on a regular basis. And what do we do when suddenly a crowd comes into town and some node usually only serves 2 clients and now has 20? So how do we scale that in time? And yeah, sometimes some node dies. Sometimes they only dies for some time. And how do we decide which subnetworks are not used anymore, and how do we get those back? And that's a problem even the WIPE cannot solve. Finally, what happens when clients roam between nodes? So when I have an address from node A and I roam to node B and I want to renew that, so node B knows nothing about that address, he will probably say, no, I can't renew that address. Here, you have a new one. And in that moment, every TCP connection that client have is broken. So to summarize that, what should a distributed DHCP server do? It should distribute and assign subrangers to MesNode, prevent double assignment of subrangers, free subrangers after some time with some mechanism, and scale available resources on nodes just in time, allow pain-free roaming for the clients, and shall not require any central component at all. And additionally, we want that every node is able to serve clients when they first come to them, and not only not so they don't need to communicate in some way to serve those clients. And we want to get rid of the mesh-wide broadcast. Okay, in the following, we will introduce some terms we will need for the later discussion about the algorithm. At first, we talked about the large network we originally distribute, and we split these large networks in small partitions, and we call those partitions blocks. And each block shall have a unique identifier, and we need some state for tracking how this block is used. And yeah, we talked about assigning blocks to nodes, so we need maybe have an owner for that block, and we wanted to regain them, so we define a timeout. And we call each these information we saw to be the community declaration. So every community needs to declare which IPv4 networks they want to distribute over the whole mesh. What is the block size? So the block size is in our example 4. What is the timeout when a distribution should fail, and when will the block be free again? When we want that a block have addresses to serve in the moment a client joins into its client network, then each block needs some amount of spare blocks, and in our case that's one. So every node should have one spare block to serve clients ad hoc. And then there's a question about how do each of those nodes communicate to each other. And we decided that those daemons distributed over the nodes should communicate via IPv6 and using multicast and unicast to each other. And we must talk to the clients with IPv4, so we expect each node to have some local address which is the same on each node. So the node didn't need any IPv4 address that's mesh-wide available. So in the beginning, each block knows nearly nothing about the network. Just started up, and it knows the community declarations we talked about, and so the basic idea, the natural idea that comes into your mind is, just ask everybody. If you could just notify everybody we reach via multicast and ask, what do you think how the network looks like? And in distributed systems, that's a pretty bad idea, because if you ask everybody with one packet, everybody may answer with a lot of packets, so we can say, hey, I'm you, and I need to know everything. And then, DDoS him, and that's no good idea. So starting is really hard, but let's assume we already have some of these blocks acquired. And we talked about earlier that a block has some timeout. So at some moment in time, this block needs to be reclaimed. So we need to send some information, we want to keep that block. And we do that by sending an update claim multicast package into the network, and then update our timeouts, and hopefully everybody else in the network will do that too. So when we think of a situation where we know nothing, we can just wait some time, and then the network will tell us how the network looked like, or how which blocks in the network are used. And we name that phase where we are waiting and learning phase. So now we know how the network looks like, and now we need to inquire some packet so we can serve the first clients, and that's pretty straightforward too. We just send an inquire message and say, hey, we like to have that node, that block, that's in our, to our knowledge is free, and then we do that some more times, so probably three times, and say, yeah, okay, we like that block, we really like that block, and then finally, if no one protests, we just say, yeah, okay, that's now our block, and we send an update claim, like everybody else did when claiming blocks. So then our block is owned by us, and everybody else sees, okay, this node has just claimed that block and writes it down. So, but in practice, not everything goes smooth. So for some reason, we could not know that this block is already owned by another block because we have some packet loss or something like that. And this block, this node then sees, yeah, someone is interested in my, or hopefully sees one of the acquire packages and says, yeah, okay, someone is interested in my block, and I will protest against that by unicasting an update claim directly to that node and say, no, that's mine. Or, yeah. The first one is okay. This first case is pretty easy. The second case is not so easy. So maybe two nodes decide, hey, that's a cool block, we want to own it, and sends an acquire for that. And then, yeah, okay, what will we do? Each node has to write its identifier into the packages it sends out, so both nodes will see an inquire and can compare that identifier and that inquire with its own identifier, and then see, okay, my identifier is smaller than the identifier of the other guy, so I am allowed to inquire that block for some more, and the loser of that comparison will just say, okay, I will choose another block. But maybe we have some kind of the situation, but we have a net split again, and so two blocks own the same, two nodes own the same block, and at some moment the net split reverses, so we have one big network again where this one block is claimed by two nodes, and at some time those two nodes will have to reclaim their block because timeout is nearing, and then yeah, they will probably both shout, yeah, update my claim, and again there's an identifier in the packet, so the node with the smaller one keeps the block, and this node with the bigger identifier just drops his claim on that block and probably will choose a new one and claim a new one. So we see we have found an algorithm which will converge to a distributed consensus about the state of the blocks, and so we can distribute blocks and so addresses to addresses for leases to the whole mesh network. We previously we were talking about what happens when clients roam. So, yeah, like I stated before, when a client roams from A to B and has an address he was given from A and needs to renew that address, he will probably tell B that, hey, I want to like to have this address some more time. And yeah, in the previous version, node B knows nothing about that address. But now, we have a little bit more knowledge about distributed addresses. So in step 2 to 3, the node B can calculate, okay, I have this address and I can derive the block number from that address. And from the block number, I can see, this block is owned by that node. So I can forward that request to node A, and then node A can say, yeah, okay, I know that MAC address or something from that client, it's okay, give him the address again, and sends back his decision on this case, and then node B can say, yeah, okay, you can have that address again. Interesting at this point is that we don't submit any DHCP options or any options at all how the network around the client is structured from A to B. We just send, yeah, you can have it. And B will then fill up all informations from the local network, from his local network to the client. So it's a pretty nice trick to move clients from one gateway to another. So when they roam, they will get a new gateway address and anything else. Okay, we implemented that idea. And we had a pretty good code review in September, and the first release in October. Yay! And now we have one community running that daemon inside of the nodes, and looks pretty well until now. We identified some potential for optimizations, which I will talk about in some moment. And next up, we will have a little more fine-tuning, and hopefully we find a bigger community than our to have it rolled out there, so we can gain more experience. So our first community was the 5.kill community, which has approximately 330 nodes. And we decided on a block timeout from roughly 5 minutes with a divider of 4 and a tentative timeout of 15 seconds. And the divider of 4 is like the blocks will not only renew the claim on blocks, the nodes will not renew the claim on blocks every 5 minutes, but we reclaim it roughly about 1 minute. So we divided the 5 minutes by 4, but the block timeout itself is 4. So when some of that reclaim packages get lost, not everybody thinks, yeah, okay, that block is free in 1 minute, and yeah, okay. So, but yeah, nothing is for free. This is a graph from our statistics on the multicast packages sent by all nodes together, and we see we have roughly 4 to 5 packets per second in the overall network. So the green line on top is the sum of all packages, and the yellow line is the inquire, the update claim packages, and then we have some small wave on the ground, which is the inquire packages. And that results in roughly 120 bytes per second in our network. So that sounds a little scary, and we had also defined some more problems. First problem is, originally we thought, yeah, okay, when we have several blocks that needs an update, then we couldn't group them together into one request for update, also update claim request. but our metric on that case totally fails. So currently, each node is sending one update claim for each packet, for each block we have. So that's not so nice. And we also discovered then that hard spare block boundary is maybe not a good idea, because in the moment the client is joining in on a node and got an address, that block he got an address from is not free anymore. So in that moment the node thinks, yeah, okay, I need a spare block, I don't have a full spare block anymore, so I need to acquire a new block. And send some acquire packages also and an update claim after that. And yeah, when that client is gone, oh, I have a block too much. I must get rid of it. So I will just let one of my blocks time out, and that's fine. And probably I will just take the new one. So when that client is just gone for roaming and will come back a moment later, and the node drops his old block, just takes a new one, the forwarding of the packet of the DHCP renew will lead to a nag. So yeah, okay, that's also a problem. So we need some metrics in there. So, but not everything is bad. We measured the traffic that is accounted during some measurement time period, and compared it to the traffic produced by DHCP itself. And the traffic produced by DHCP is 5 times smaller than the one produced by DHCP on the network, which is pretty nice. And as I mentioned before, we have some optimization room where we can probably get that number to 10 with a block timeout we chosen. Okay, what are the benefits from using DDHCPD? Yeah, okay, we have nearly client independent network traffic load, and importantly less than before. The nearly is, yeah, you have seen the waves in the graphs, and we hope to get rid of that waves. We have instant address serving, so when a client joins the AP or the node, then it instantly have an address. You had no packet loss problems there anymore, and that's pretty nice. And we have no coordination overhead above what we have earlier. And we can, the implementation allows adaption of DHCP options during runtime, and we have a hook mechanism where we can, which can be used to integrate that daemon into other parts of your firmware. So it will say hello when, raise an event when a node is, client is joined, and will also say something if a client leaves, and some more statistical information where you can produce something from. Okay. Yeah, what is our roadmap until now? I think I said anything of that earlier. Point 4. We have to reduce the effect of startup. Currently, the learning mode is a time where a node cannot give leases to clients because it has no block. We want to get rid of that learning phase to initially start up in the moment we can, because when you increase the block out time out to, let's say, 18 hours, your node needs to wait 18 hours before it can serve the first address to a client, and that's a pretty long time. And even smaller times like 1 hour is not discussable. So we want to get rid of that, the effect, and work without learning mode, and we have some ideas how to how we can do that. Yeah, and of course for that cleanups. Yeah. So what have we managed to do? We decentralized DHCP into the mesh nodes. We have less client depending traffic on the network. We have more reliable and faster DHCP operations, and we have a mesh network without the need for centralized components. Any questions? I think we have a micro.
For the startup, why don't you choose like a random block with very short leases till you have the full picture?
Yeah, when we start up, we choose a random block. We could just do that. We know nothing about the network. We choose a random block and just claim, try to inquire on it. But if you try that in a crowded mesh network, the probability that this block you just randomly choose is already in use. So you say, yeah, I'm acquire that block. Some other node says, no, that's mine. You say, yeah, I acquire that another block, and then and so on and so on. So yeah, you produce traffic by doing so. And if you have a power failover in your city, and every node come up again, you will kill your network by bothers traffic. And that's, okay, so we don't want that.
That doesn't happen too often, no?
It doesn't happen too often, but our idea there is that we could somehow memorize the blocks a node previously had, and we can reduce the changing blocks every time and keep the old ones. And probably if every node does that and then tries to regain those blocks or reclaim those blocks at startup, the probability that those blocks are in use is very small. So yeah, we'll test that.
How do you face the problem with fragmentation of the blocks?
Fragmentation of the blocks. Can you explain this?
Yeah, if you have a block at the beginning of the whole pool and one at the end, and you have much broadcast addresses and network addresses.
We don't use the.
Okay.
You usually have your broadcast address when you really think of subnetworks.
Yeah.
We don't think of subnetworks in that case. So we just think of, we have this block and there are four addresses in, and we serve them to the clients.
Okay.
So we don't build up these networks. The interfaces where the clients sit off on and the netmasks the clients should see are rather big. So span the whole network you share, distribute over this DHCP.
How do you cope with the IPv6 addressing for the multicast at the beginning?
Again, please.
How do you address the IPv6 for multicast? Because basically it means that your node already have IPv6 connectivity or addresses.
We join a defined multicast group, and the IP stack is doing all the work for us.
Yes, but if you join it, you already have an IPv6 then on the node.
Sorry, yes.
If you join the multicast, then you already have an IPv6, which identifies you. So you solve the issue
already.
We have
the link local address, probably.
So why don't you try to encode some addresses, like if you need 4 and 6, if you already have this notion of addressing?
When we have some mechanism with encode 4 and 6, we need an IPv4 address, and we don't want that, because then every node has an IPv4 address and we have to manage that again. And so we just use the link local address on the mesh interfaces, and that works pretty well. No further questions? Okay, then thank you for your attention, and if you want to check out the code, it's on GitHub, and you can contact me directly or speak to me afterwards. Thank you.